And welcome on into the program, my friend. This is Basic Instructions Before Leaving Earth, and today is Wednesday, September 17th, 2014. And on today's program, we are going to be continuing our journey through Matthew, and we'll be coming to Matthew chapter 5, and the first of three major discourses that was given by the Lord Jesus, and that being the Sermon on the Mount. And as we come to this, we should consider that the real test for any teaching in Scripture is not only if it works for us, but are we interpreting and applying it correctly in our lives? After all, we must understand that all Scripture is for us, but not all Scripture is to us. So as we come to the Sermon on the Mount in these next few chapters, in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, it's important for us to know to whom Jesus was speaking and what he was really saying. So if you have your Bible with you, you'll want to turn to Matthew chapter 5, and we'll pick it up in verse 1 there. But any time that we study the Word of God, we always want to begin with prayer, don't we? So if you would, please bow your heart with me. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for your word. And we just, Father, thank you for this time that you've given to us to study your word. We ask, Father, that you would send your Holy Spirit to teach us and guide us into the understanding of your word. And that you would just go with us now, Lord, as we explore this marvelous sermon that was given by your son Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Now, as we come today to the so-called Sermon on the Mount, which will span again through Matthew 5, 6, and 7, and you will find excerpts of it also in the other Gospels, but Matthew's record of it is by far the most comprehensive, and I believe that the reason for that is that Matthew had the capability of taking shorthand. He was a customs official, and that was actually a job requirement to record the commercial transactions that took place. A publican at this time had that skill, like a stenographer today. There was a form of shorthand that Matthew would have been required to know. And that's why Matthew, I believe, was able to take down these discourses virtually verbatim. And if you notice, his gospel is the longest of the four gospels that we have, probably for that reason. Now, before we get into the sermon here, let's begin, because there's a very few important things that I'd like to say first. To begin with, the far left and the far right are not conformed to politics, not confined, I should say, actually. And by that, I mean that there are, among theologians, those that are extreme liberals, and also those who are extreme conservatives in their exposition of Scripture. And that is not revealed in a more vivid manner than it is in the understanding of the Sermon on the Mount, which we're about to get to. You see, the liberal theologian, he's the far left. He treats the Sermon on the Mount as though it is the gospel itself. And he acts, even if he doesn't say it, as though it is the only important part of Scripture. I've seen some liberal preachers on TV saying that all they need in the Bible is the Sermon on the Mount. And they carry it with them, you know, and they try to live by it, and that's all that they need. Well, may I say, that's very pious. And it's actually pious drivel to talk like that. The question is not whether you feel that the Sermon on the Mount is your religion or your creed. The important thing is what the Sermon on the Mount reveals, actually, about the nature of man, of all mankind. for that matter. And we'll have the occasion to comment on that as we go into it. And this may seem like an extreme viewpoint, but it actually represents a very large segment of liberalism today. And very candidly, it's an entirely erroneous view. Please hear me, will you, very carefully, my beloved. The content of the Christian gospel is not found in the Sermon on the Mount. For instance, there is absolutely no mention of the death and resurrection of Christ. Paul said to the Corinthians over in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 and 2, "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you have believed in vain." And what is that gospel? The Sermon on the Mount? No, he says that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. And my friend, that's not here. The gospel is not in the Sermon on the Mount, but a great many people like to hold it up that way because it sounds very pious to do that. And I believe that that type of preaching has made more hypocrites in the church than anything else. If a man is honest, he's going to look at the Sermon on the Mount and know that he's not living up to it. And if that's God's standard, and by the way it is, then you come short of it. And what are you going to do then? Do you have a Savior? Do you have one that can extend mercy to you and reach down in grace and save you by faith because you're not able to meet his standard? But this group, they talk nothing about that. This is the extreme liberal group. And the other extreme is the conservative, the extreme right. And this group treats the Sermon on the Mount like it's just the bubonic plague and they want nothing to do with it. They say it's not for us. Well, again, may I say this, it may not be to us, but it is for us, my friend. This is the law of the kingdom, given by the king himself. It is the highest ethical teaching in the Bible, vastly even beyond the law of Moses. The Ten Commandments, which are a subset of the law of Moses, are amplified and expanded upon here. And if you thought the Ten Commandments was hard to keep, wait till you see what Jesus does with them here. He raises the law to the nth degree. He immediately sets it on a higher plane. Now, it is true that there is no gospel in the Sermon on the Mount, and it's tragic to try to give it to unsaved men as the standard of conduct, and lead them to think that if they try to measure up to it, that they're going to be a Christian. You see, man could not keep the law in the Old Testament. So then how in the world is he going to keep the Sermon on the Mount, which is even higher? That is, in his own strength. And it's likewise true that the method for living the Christian life is not really found in the Sermon on the Mount. It gives the ethic without supplying the dynamic, if I may. There's nothing here about living in the power of the Holy Spirit. But I believe that the primary purpose of the Sermon on the Mount is to set before men the law of the kingdom. After all, what have we been talking about here in the Gospel of Matthew? The king. The king has come to prevent himself. He began by preaching the gospel of the kingdom and calling disciples to follow him. And now he enunciates the law of his kingdom. It's the king's manifesto here. And the Christian who calls him Lord will seek to obey the law that he gives here. But he'll also recognize that he is only able to do so in the power of the Holy Spirit. Now the Sermon on the Mount needs to be preached to let men know that they fall short of his glory. The Sermon on the Mount lets men know that they're sinners. It reveals that none are righteous, and we all come short of the glory of God. But the Sermon on the Mount, if you look at it and really understand it, then it'll bring you to a Savior who died for you on the cross. Now, these principles that are laid out here are for us today. And it reveals how far we come short, but it still sets before us a high goal. Now, we have here the opening of the Sermon on the Mount. Well, you notice Matthew chapter 5, verse 1. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Now, notice first he sits down, and that was the normal teaching posture for a rabbi in that day, and his disciples come to him now. Verse 2, he opened his mouth and began to teach them, saying, now, you see, he did not actually give the Sermon on the Mount to the multitudes. He gave it to his disciples. And that is so important for us to see. He gave it to those who were already his. And don't misunderstand me. It was because he saw the multitudes and saw their need, and this is given indirectly to them. But it's given through people who are already his followers. And I believe today that men need first to come to Christ. Now, will you notice he teaches them, saying, verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, the poor in spirit, well, it doesn't tell you how to become the poor in spirit. It just says the poor in spirit. And in the Greek, it's tokol to pneumati. And my Greek friends will have to excuse my enunciation. But it carries the meaning of humility. It's the opposite of self-sufficiency. It's recognizing your own utter spiritual bankruptcy apart from God. It describes those who are acutely conscious of their own lostness and hopelessness apart from divine grace. And does that describe you, my friend? Do you see that you're lost without God? Or do you still think that you're a sweet little Sunday school boy or girl? Now, only the saved sinner today can know his poverty of spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit. And this is the antithesis of the worldly view of blessedness. It's the exact opposite of what we see around us today. The worldly idea is that happiness and blessings are found in riches and abundance and in leisure and such things like that. But the truth is directly opposed to that. You see? May I say, beloved, don't be taken in by that type of thing. Don't look at the material things around you and measure how blessed you are by that. Only the Spirit of God can reveal to you your poverty of spirit. These are citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Paul says, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, yet possessing all things. And that's over in 2 Corinthians 6. And that's spiritual riches, by the way. He gives that in his second letter to the Corinthians. And notice here the next verse that Jesus gives. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And by the way, if you look back, you will find all of these given elsewhere also. The poor in spirit is given in Zephaniah 3:12. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And that's in Micah 7:1. And this speaks of mourning over sin, the godly sorrow that produces repentance leading to salvation without any regret. And the comfort is the comfort of forgiveness and salvation. Then we find next, verse 5, blessed are the gentle, or blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And that's in Psalm 37:11. And my friend, the gentle, the meek, are not inheriting this earth today. I'm sure that you recognize that. If you don't, just look around. They're not. And this apparently is not in effect today. But when he's reigning, now when he's reigning, the meek are going to inherit the earth. And we'll have some more to say about that verse next time. But we're going to stop there for now. And I would encourage you to go back and reread what we've covered in this brief beginning to the Sermon on the Mount today. Also, go ahead and read forward through the rest of Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7 to get a little sneak preview for what we're going to be looking at next time. And as we go to sign off now, before we do, as always, we want to leave you with your thought. To meditate upon. The Beatitudes are the essence, the lifeblood, and the beating heart of authentic, ancient, and living Christianity. And we will be back next time. Again, I would encourage you to reread these first four verses of Matthew chapter 5. Go ahead and read all the way through to the end of chapter 7 of Matthew. You'll see this complete discourse of the Sermon on the Mount that Matthew records for us here. It can be quite overwhelming, but that's what we're going to be delving into next time. And until then, may God richly bless you, my beloved. See you later.